told you you were trouble, you'll forever be alone. When you told you you should run away, you'd never find a home.
Okay, guys, we're back. This is Joel with Big Love Radio. I'm your host, and my wife, everybody's with us, but like I said, we're having technical difficulties. It's really an ID10T error, which is an idiot error on my part. I just can't seem to get camera two working, guys. So we do have a full house with us. Everybody say hello.
Hello.
Hello, hello, hello. Everybody's here. So what we're going to do, Natalie, is just we're going to turn it over to you, young lady, and just let you let the Holy Spirit use you and just share whatever it is that you want to share, and you may want to pull your mic up a little closer. So you
is that better?
That is great.
Okay.
So,
to start kind of from the beginning, to mm-hmm. sort of bring it together and make more sense, my mother was Jewish.
Okay.
So I'm Jewish by birth.
Okay.
My father was a Christian. So I grew up in both.
Okay.
I grew up going to synagogue. I celebrated Hanukkah, Passover, Yom Kippur, the whole bit, was in church. So really got a good mixture of both of them. However, like so many people, when they're younger, you hear these stories of, you know, Noah and the ark, and you hear about Jonah and the whale, and, you know, you hear all these fabulous stories, but you don't hear about the depth and the relationship with Jesus.
Right.
And you don't hear about the Holy Spirit. It's just sort of overlooked.
Yeah.
So I was very active, very involved, but my parents were divorced when I was 5, and I'm grateful for that. However, I did, with my father, as well as some other family members and a stepbrother, had been a victim of molestation from the ages of 4 until the ages of 13.
Oh. Wow. Yeah.
And my mother was my world, and very close with my dad's parents and his sister. So I had a really good childhood as far as those influences that I did have. Mm-hmm. But then there was the secret part of it that I always kept quiet because I was too ashamed. And my mother ended up meeting my stepdad when I was 12. And wonderful guy, but at that time I hated him because I felt like he was taking my mom away from me. Mm-hmm. And she was my rock. They ended up getting married when I was 14. I ended up being date raped at 14 in their home. And I could not even fathom how this God that was supposed to be so loving and so good, how he could allow all of these things to happen to an innocent child. And I just got angrier and angrier and angrier, and I started cutting. And I was just covered in scars.
So you were angry with God or just angry?
I was angry with
in
God.
General? Okay.
No, I was pissed.
Okay. Okay.
If I can say that.
Yeah,
I mean,
of course you can.
Downright angry.
Sure.
That he could allow all these things to happen to a child. So it was the cutting. I had gone through therapy.
And this was at 12?
No, at 14.
At 14, okay.
Mm-hmm. I was sent through therapy. I was told I was manic depressive, that I was bipolar. My father had actually been diagnosed as being severely bipolar and borderline paranoid schizophrenic.
Okay.
So they told me that I inherited it. So they were throwing this curse on me
right.
on top
Speaking
of everything
it right
else.
Into your life, right.
And so they put me on lithium. And
oh, no.
I just got worse and worse.
I'm not sure what that is. What is lithium?
Lithium
I know
is,
it is a
mood,
battery.
It's
That's
a
it.
Mood stabilizer.
Okay, a mood stabilizer.
Right.
Okay, at 14. Wow.
At 14.
Yeah.
And at that point, I'm like, you know what? I want nothing to do with God anymore. So I denounced God completely. Mm. And I ended up making a actual blood pact with Satan. Mm. Because it was those... It made it seem so appealing.
What made it appealing?
Now, don't think I'm nuts.
No, I mean, I just want you to be real.
When I was a very little girl...
Right.
I used to see things.
Okay.
And but it was very, it was beautiful. And it was like fairies. Mm-hmm. And because I was an only child.
Okay.
And everybody thought, you know, these were imaginary friends mm-hmm. that kids have. But I was actually seeing these things. And it was almost like it was luring me in at that point. But this beautiful deception, this beautiful side of evil.
Okay.
Oh. And so it really lured me right in. And it was that instant gratification. It was nobody can hurt you anymore. You can be in control. All these things are going to be at your disposal. Because God's not helping you. But I will. So you've got the enemy over here just spewing all these lies.
Right. And you're 14. So
and I'm 14.
You're believing them.
Exactly.
Didn't know what to believe. Right. Okay.
So nothing else would work.
Right.
So I started, and I, like I said, I made this blood pact, and I got into the Necronomicon very heavily, which is...
Explain what that is. So, okay, some, you know, the listeners.
You're basically going and opening the gates of hell.
Okay.
To summarize it.
Okay, let me ask you this, and maybe I want you to express something. You know, if there's anybody out there listening right now that may have children... that are struggling, and that's a big thing is cutting nowadays.
Yeah.
So if you could say something to the people listening about what to look for other than the cutting, of course, what would be some of the symptoms or something for parents to look out for, or grandparents for that matter?
I would say one of the big things with me, and I know a lot of other people, is it's that isolation.
Okay.
You tend to isolate yourself. From a lot of other people because you don't want it to be noticed.
So were you kind of an outgoing person prior to this?
I've always been outgoing.
Okay.
But I was also a loner.
Okay, so.
I was perfectly okay.
Being, okay.
I could lock myself up in my room for hours and I'd be fine.
So guys, if you have kids or grandkids even for that matter and you notice, you know, some isolation things or just different personality traits that aren't normal, that's definitely something would you want to question them? Would you want to talk to them and say, hey, what's going on? Or how,
you know, here's
what do you
thing.
Think? Okay.
And I feel I'm very passionate about this. I don't have children.
Okay.
I was never blessed to have children, but I see this time and time again. And I know with me, parents be proactive in your child's life.
Amen.
Don't yes. just set them in front of a computer. Don't just set them in front of their phone and their iPad
video
and their video games.
Right.
Because you have no idea. I mean, you can see this, it could be this innocent cartoon. And when you look at the underlying message, it's demonic.
That's happening a lot
and,
now.
And parents aren't taking enough interest in their kids' lives because they're too busy doing what they need to do. And they're letting their kid go so that they're not bothered. Be proactive.
Amen.
Okay. And I'm sorry, but I was not allowed just to shut my door and say, no, mom can't come in here.
Oh, no.
Mom could come in my room anytime she wanted
Absolutely.
To. So I got kind of smart about trying to hide things.
Okay.
And there was a point in time when, you know, mom, when I was like 14, 15, when she didn't come in so much. And when she finally did... She could not believe what she found. I mean, I had all these demonology books, all these witchcraft books. I had a Ouija board. I had an altar. I had altar stuff all around. And she was horrified. She took all this stuff, went straight down to the church, gave them to our pastor, and had me sit down with him.
Yeah.
But I can't stress that enough.
Okay.
It's just be proactive.
Amen.
You know, Amen. Talk to your kids. You know, find out what's going on. And it's not that my mom didn't, but I was very rebellious. I mean, very rebellious.
Yeah.
So, in long sleeves.
Oh, yeah. That's another thing people to watch out for. Long sleeves in the summer. It's 100 degrees in Texas, baby.
And you're wearing
If your kids have got long sleeves, that's
question.
A question. Big question.
So I went that way for a very long time.
Okay, so
and
how many years do you think this went
21
on?
Total.
21 total years. So you were into
years.
Witchcraft all this time and
yes.
into, okay.
Yes. And it went from the black magic, the hoodoo, the voodoo, then it went into the white magic, the Wicca.
Okay.
Where they say, you know, do as you will, though you harm none. No. None of it is of God. And it is beautiful as anybody can make that side of evil look. It's still evil. Well, your horoscope.
Yeah. Right.
Picking up a paper or looking on the internet and reading your horoscope for the day. That is witchcraft. Going to a psychic, going to a medium. Those are witchcraft. It talks about it in the Bible.
So what would you tell somebody? Like, I mean, how do you explain to somebody that may be doing that, that it's witchcraft? How do you define that, and how can you explain that to them?
Don't take my word for it.
Okay.
Go to the Word.
Okay.
Go to the truth. And it lays out in Scripture. It tells you what is not of God.
Okay.
It tells you to stay away from those soothsayers, to stay away from those mediums. It lays it out.
Amen.
So don't take my word for it.
I just want to ask, what drew you to want to go into witchcraft? Was it, what was so appealing about that side of everything that made you?
Power.
I see. Okay.
The power, the control, mm-hmm. that I felt that I could have because I didn't have it anywhere else.
Yeah.
But that was promising me this power and this control. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you one thing.
Yeah.
The enemy has power.
I know.
He has power.
Yeah.
And people who don't believe that that is real, they need to wake up.
Amen.
Because it is very real. Mm-hmm. But he can only have power that we give him.
I was going to say that we allow him to have.
Exactly.
Amen.
Exactly. And Tanisha and I and our friend Kelly, Mama Kelly, we got the privilege of going to Mardi Gras this past year.
Okay.
To go out, join up with another group, and go out on the streets and preach.
Who?
Yes.
But y'all were hated on Mardi Gras. They didn't want to hear that.
I went there in my early 20s to party. And when I saw these groups out there preaching, I was the one flashing, throwing stuff at them, yelling at them. Now God sends me there to go out and preach, and now people are doing this to me, right?
Right, right.
All right, Lord.
Yeah.
But, and here's the thing that I can't stress enough with this, is when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, okay, we now, because of the resurrection, we sit beside Him.
Amen.
On that right hand. We're given that same authority.
Yes, ma'am.
That Jesus has.
Amen.
Okay. So as long as we're under that covering and we know who our daddy is and we know who our brother is.
Amen.
That authority is ours. Satan has no power.
Power at all. Amen.
None.
You know, there was something you said about when you first said about the power reminded me when I went through Victory Outreach, we went out to the streets and a couple of houses down, we went to talk to this lady and she was a witch. She claimed witchcraft, claimed she was a witch. And the first thing she said to Pastor Frank and myself, she said, "You Christians are so stupid." And I'm a new Christian. I'm like, "Well, what do you mean, ma'am?" She said, "You know, we think we have the power, but you Christians have all the power and don't even know it." And that's always stuck with me.
Really?
And that's exactly what you're talking about.
Well, and there's something else I wanted to say about that.
Okay.
Is when you're dealing with witchcraft, you have to have these talismans. You have your altar set up. You've got your, you know, your salt for protection. And you've got your, you know, your African or Buddha figure or, you know, your athame set up over here, your candles, this and that. All of these things are helping to conjure up that power. Okay.
Okay.